That's a lovely set of flowers.
Oh, let's take it. Got to take a picture of that.
Very well. Can you do me a favour, please?
Yes, sir. I'm here. Assist.
Just hold on to this for me.
So it doesn't topple over.
It doesn't topple over.
Right. I will need to move, though, because I'm one of the poor workers.
Okay. No, I'll be back. No. You'll be standing there. Okay.
know his inner peace, and his grace he freely gives.
Thank you, Carol. We're going to hear two readings now. The first one, Psalm 91, read by Owen, and then Anita will read John chapter 14.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm reading Psalms 91, verse 1 to 16. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked if you say, the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling. No harm will overtake you, nor disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent because he loves you, says the Lord. I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
John 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going, Thomas said to him. Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Now we hear our next hymn, that hymn, Great is Thy Faith.
Morning, my Stared at her. He returned the following weekend and asked her out on a date. They were married a few years later on July
They were blessed with their only child, me. After they were married, Mum and Dad used to love dressing up and going out partying. They would go to the Lyceum in the Strand or Dorchester for a dinner and dance event, and the annual Jamaican independence celebrations at Brent Town Hall. Dad would always make sure Mum looked her best when they went out. This even continued after Mum was saved and became a Christian. When Mum got dressed to go to church, she'd shout, "Mervyn, have a look." Dad replied, "Tom, Mum, what, yeah, you got one." He wasn't shy in giving his opinions. If Mum's outfit didn't look quite right, he would offer suggestions like, "Why not change that top? Or why not try a different colour?" I'm proud to say, Mum and Dad worked hard together to provide a happy, loving environment that allowed me to be the person I am today. Dad and I would often take on development projects together, at home together. This experience was both daunting, but at the same time, loads of fun. We would often bicker like husband and wife, but finish the task at hand. I never appreciated it at the time, but this father-daughter bonding helped me to become the independent woman I am today. I remember on one occasion when we were digging the foundations for the extension. Immediately afterwards, there was a deluge of rain. And as a result, the trench was filled with rainwater. Dad and I spent the next 3 to 4 hours bailing water. Needless to say, I had to take 2 baths afterwards to get rid of the dirt and the mud off me. Dad worked in a number of engineering companies, but his final job was at Hendon Police Training College at Hendon, where he took early retirement and afterwards pursued his love of carpentry. A passionate cultivator, Dad enjoyed planting vegetables and fruits. He loved sharing the fruits of his labour with family and close friends. It was often a running joke with his friends at the allotment because he was always the last to sow, but the first to reap. This was because his passion drove him to spend so much time tending to the crop, making sure he got the best produce. Just to illustrate Dad's commitment, technically he would leave in May and return in September. He could have been a greengrocer sharing pumpkin, sweet corn, potatoes, peas, onions, tomatoes and cucumbers. As anyone can see, Dad was a very handsome man, and with Mum at his side they made a beautiful couple, enjoying over 57 years of marriage. I once brought a friend home from school. When she saw his picture hanging in the living room, she said, "Poor, he's good looking." I showed her to the door and never invited her back. Along with being handsome, he was well dressed. A key element to his attire was his baseball cap. Dad was never seen without it. He only took it off on special occasions, such as going to church to celebrate a christening, wedding, or funeral. A great storyteller, Dad would often hold everyone's attention when sharing stories of his youth. I remember him telling me about the parrot that used to live on the veranda of his mum's house. When he came home from school, he would often run into the kitchen try and help himself to the sugar. The parrot was the main reason why he often got caught. It alerted Gran before he could reach it, saying in broad patois, "Mervyn eating the sugar," and would repeat this until Gran arrived. Dad loved sport, and in particular cricket. He played for a while in Jamaica and continued in the UK with his good friend Calvin Williams. He also loved playing dominoes and a flutter on horses. A couple of years ago, some friends invited me to Ascot. When I got there, I'd call him before each race for tips on which horse to bet on. Needless to say, I came home with some very welcome winnings. Anyone fortunate to know Dad would tell you he was very generous. He loved sharing what he had, including his time with people. Dad was a perfectionist and an excellent handyman. This perfectionism, however, meant that although he approached projects with enthusiasm, it took him ages to complete them. Dad loved wildlife programs, politics and music. We'd like to give a special mention to Monroe Gordon. Monroe has been more than a friend to my dad and the family. We would describe their relationship as more like father and son. They were always together, whether at the allotment or taking dad to his hospital appointments when mum
Dad would never admit it, but as it became harder and harder for him to attend his lottery, Monroe was on hand to support him. We believe this is a true example of friendship. There are so many wonderful stories about my dad, but it will take me all day to tell you all. We all have our wonderful memories of him. Just remember one and smile. All the friendships he had over the years, he would be given nicknames. Butter, as a youngster in Jamaica, growing up in Jamaica. Here in the UK, there were numerous ones, including Uncle Mac, Uncle Mackie, Mr. Mervyn, Mr. McNickie, McNickle, E.T., but the one I love best is Dad. Rest in peace, Dad. We love you.
Some of those memories will have gone through your minds. Memories of times and occasions that you've spent together over the years. And of course, some of those memories will bring tears of sadness, but other memories will bring lots of smiles of joy. And I think it's very important that as we go on from here, that you continue to share the memories that you have of him, to keep talking about him and remembering the times. And yes, sometimes it will be difficult and it will cause you to cry, but other times, as I said, there'll be lots of smiles and you'll find yourself laughing as you enjoy the memories of him. And I think it's important to share those memories for two reasons. And the first is that as you share the memories, then of course it will help you in your time of sadness and grief. It will help you in your journey of grief that sadly we all have to go through following the loss of someone we have loved. But secondly, and I think perhaps more importantly, as you share the memories and the emotions that they bring, then of course you will keep Mervyn's love, his life, his joy, his spirit alive within the context of family and friends. As we gather today for this funeral, we are of course reminded in the Christian church that we are in the season of Lent as we prepare to celebrate Easter. But as we know in the Christian faith, to get to Easter, we have to go through a Good Friday. We have to experience the death of Jesus on the cross. And Jesus had to experience death to understand what we as human beings would have to go through. But the wonderful thing is, of course, that on Easter Sunday, he was raised again from death. He broke the power of death and was raised to a new and eternal life. And that's why I always say as well that when it comes to funerals, yes, they are sad occasions, but they are also a time for us to celebrate and acknowledge that Mervyn's journey here on earth has now sadly come to an end, and you can no longer see him here on earth. But in the Christian faith, of course, we believe he has been raised to a new and eternal life, that he has been raised to rest with his Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Saviour. But he has been reunited with all of those that he has known and loved who have gone before him. And I pray that God's blessing will go with Mervyn as he continues the journey. And of course, I pray that God's blessing, peace, and strength will be with each and every one of you who mourn his passing today. Amen. I'd like to just say a short prayer and then we'll say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather here today, filled with sadness and grief, we do gather also to give thanks. To give thanks for Mervyn, to give thanks for his love, his life, his joy, his spirit, to give thanks for all of his gifts, his talents, his interests, and all that he has accomplished during his journey here on earth. And although today we are filled with sadness and grief, help us to take some comfort in the knowledge that now for Mervyn the sorrows and the sickness of this life are no more, that death is past, and that he has been raised to a new and eternal life, to rest eternally in your love and care. Lord, I pray for those who mourn Mervyn's passing today. I pray for the family, for relatives, friends and neighbours, for those here today and for those who are joining us from different parts of this country and the world, for all who mourn Mervyn's passing. May all know the peace that passes all understanding, and may all know that neither death nor life can separate anyone from the love that they have known in Mervyn, and from the perfect love that is shown to us in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. And so we join together as we say the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so now let us entrust our brother Mervyn to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Lord, I pray that your light will perpetually shine upon Mervyn. Grant to him eternal peace and rest. And to those of us who continue our journey here on earth, grant to us comfort and peace, now and forevermore. Amen. May the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
spread that around. Will you take the trust, please? Right. What we're going to do to prevent from scraping any damage, we're going to keep an eye all the way to the edges of the North High Road and we'll put that road over there. Thank you.
Right. Russ.
Take your position, yeah, man.
The life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I'd like to thank you on behalf of the family of Mr. Mervyn, Aunt Winnie, Harrow, for you taking the time out to come and join with us as we say this farewell to Uncle Mervyn. At this time, I'd like to ask Chair Campbell if she'd like to come forward to share that photo. Mind.
Remind me. Dear God, when I am lonely and when I feel despair, let not my ailing heart forget you hear my every prayer. Remind me that no matter what I do or fail to do, there's still hope for me as long as I have faith in you. Let not my eyes be blinded by some folly I commit, but help me to regret my wrong and to make up for it. Inspire me to put my fears upon a hidden shelf and in the future never to be sorry for myself. Give me the restful sleep I need before another dawn and bless me in the morning with the courage to go.
Thank you so much. And I'm going to invite my cousin to come and share the vision of the room.
Good afternoon. Mervyn Leroy was born on the 26th of May 1938 to a dignified by McNickle to Philophilus McNickle. He was the youngest boy of six that spent the first 10 years of his life in Williamsfield, St. Elizabeth. Then the family moved to Caron Hall, St. Mary, where he attended Caron Hall Primary School. After leaving high school, Dad went on to agricultural school. Dad's first job was in the post office, but he soon realised that his passion was for cultivating. So he left the post office and started working on the family farm. He left Jamaica and traveled to the UK, where he lived in Lewiston. He met Mum while he was visiting friends at the house where Mum was living. The friends had set up the meeting by asking Mum to bring him a glass of water. When she returned with the water, Dad just stared at her. He returned the following weekend and asked her out on a date. They were married a few years later, on 27th of July. They were best with their only child, me. After they were married, Mum and Dad used to love dressing up and going out partying. They would go to the Lyceum in the Strand, the Dorchester Dim and Dance events, and the annual Jamaican Independence celebrations at Brentown Hall. Dad would always make sure Mum looked her best when they went out. This even continued after Mum was saved and became a Christian. When Mum got dressed to go to church, she would shout, "Mervyn, come and look." Dad would reply, "Turn around. Yeah, you can go on." He wasn't shy in giving his opinions if Mum's outfit didn't look quite right. He would offer suggestions like, "Why not change the top? Or why not try a different colour?" I'm proud to say Mum and Dad worked hard together to provide a happy, loving environment that allowed me to become the person I am today. Dad and I would often take on development projects at home together. This experience was both daunting and at the same time loads of fun. We would often bicker like husband and wife, but finish the task at hand. I never appreciated it at the time, but this father-daughter bonding helped me to become the independent woman I am today. I remember on one occasion, we were digging the foundations for the extension. Immediately after, there was a deluge of rain. As a result, the trench was filled with rainwater. and Dad and I spent the next 3 to 4 hours bathing in water. I had to have 2 baths afterwards just to get rid of the dirt and mud off me. Dad worked for a number of engineering companies, but his last job was at Hendon Beach Training College in Hendon, where he took early retirement and afterwards pursued his love of carpentry. A passionate cultivator, Dad enjoyed planting vegetables and fruits. He loved sharing the fruits of his labour with family and close friends. It was often a running joke with his friends at the allotment because he was the last to sow but the first to reap. This was because his passion drove him to spend so much of his time tending to his crop, making sure he got the best produce. Just to illustrate Dad's commitment, technically he would leave home in May and return in September. He could have been a greengrocer, sharing pumpkins, sweet corn, potatoes, peas, onions, tomatoes, and cucumbers. As anyone can see, Dad was a very handsome man. With Mum by his side, they made a beautiful couple, enjoying over 57 years of marriage. I once brought a friend home from school. When she saw his picture hanging in the living room, she said, "Cool, he's good looking." I showed her to the door and never invited her back. Along with being handsome, he was well dressed. A key element to his attire was his baseball cap. Dad was never seen without it. He only took it off on special occasions, such as going to church to celebrate a christening, wedding, or funeral. A great storyteller, Dad would hold everyone's attention when sharing stories of his youth. I remember him telling me about the parrot that lived on the veranda of his mum's house. When he came home from school, he would often run into the kitchen and try and help himself to the sugar. The parrot was the main reason why he often got caught. It alerted Gran before he could reach it, saying in broad patois, "Mervyn eating the sugar," and would repeat this until Gran arrived. Dad loved sport, in particular cricket. He played for a while in Jamaica and continued in the UK with his good friend Calvin Williams. He also loved to play dominoes and a fusser on the horses. A couple of years ago, some friends invited me to Ascot. When I got there, I called him before each race for tips on which horse to bet on. Needless to say, I came home with some very welcome news. Anyone fortunate to know Dad would tell you he was very generous. He loved sharing what he had, including his time with people. Dad was a perfectionist and an excellent handyman. This perfectionism, however, meant that although he approached projects at home with enthusiasm, it took him ages to complete. Dad loved wildlife programs, politics, and music. We would like to give a special mention to Monroe Gordon. Monroe has been more than a friend to my dad and the family. We would describe his relationship as more like father and son. They were always together, whether at the allotment or taking Dad to his hospital appointments when Mum and I were unable to do so. Dad would never admit it, but as it became harder and harder for him to attend to his allotment, Monroe was on hand to support him. We believe this is a true example of friendship. There's been so many wonderful stories about my dad that it would take me all day to tell you. We all have our wonderful memories of him. Just remember one and smile. All the friendships that Dad had over the years, he would be given a nickname, Butter, as a youngster growing up in Jamaica. Here in the UK, there were numerous ones, including Uncle Mac, Uncle Mackie, Mr. Merv, Mr. McNickie, McNickle, and E2. But the one I love best is Dad. Rest in peace, Dad. We love you.
In 20, I took a trip to Jamaica to visit with my family. My dad, Emery Myles, we were hoping that his birthday, as a matter of fact, my dad and Uncle Mervyn were born in the same year, but dad beat him to the punch. He was born on the 9th of March. But in 2017, when I was in Jamaica, I spent a lot of time talking with dad. And he would often talk about family. He would talk about growing up in Ben Lomond. He would talk about the friends he knew. We talk about our various family members, our dying, of course, which I still remember her funeral. Uncle Mervyn as well. And the thing that dad really impressed on me was family is important. The way we choose to live our lives is also important. Unfortunately, my dad didn't live to see his 80th birthday. However, the following year, I was privileged enough to go and celebrate Uncle Mervyn's 80th birthday. And it was a wonderful occasion. I have wonderful memories of meeting with the family and just enjoying seeing him with this broad smile on his face and the customary baseball cap. And it occurs to me that this is a path that we all take, whether we like it or not. But we're told that death is merely a doorway by which we go through. Some liken it to a ship leaving from a port, heading for another destination, and as it disappears over the horizon, while we are saying goodbye, others are seeing it heading towards you. I know it's hard because we miss people that have been such an integral part of our lives. But I'm also reminded that death is not the end. And though it's painful and though it's really difficult to bear the loss, to see the empty chair, to not hear their voice, it comforts me, as I hope it will also comfort you and everyone who is here who has precious memories of Uncle Mervyn, that this is not the end. It's merely a see you later. So may we continue to hold his memory in our hearts. May we continue to remember him for who he is. And as I said in the church, the God we believe in is a God of the living, not the dead. So therefore, as much as we have a body here, this body is just a shell. Uncle Mervyn has gotten his upgrade. A body that will never decay. It will never grow weary. It won't have aches and pains. And we have the hope of a joy, a joyous reunion when this life is over. So I'd like us to take this time to remember him, to give thanks to God for him, and also to remember life is precious. Nobody knows how long we have. Uncle Mervyn got a good innings. We might not all do the same. So let us enjoy our family, our loved ones, our friends, each day that we have, every breath that we take. Because in these days, nothing is promised. So remember Uncle Mervyn for the joy, not that he was, but the joy that he is. And I'd like to ask us if we could just take a moment's silence and then we pray. Father God, we thank you for the life of your child, Mervyn. We thank you for lending him to us, for giving him a good life, for giving him a wonderful wife and a precious daughter. We thank you for the person who he has been for so many. He's been a brother, a cousin, a friend, husband, dad, and so much more to so many people. Remember him. We pray, Lord, that you will keep him in your care. And as we long for the day when we will be reunited, we thank you that you give us this hope, that you remind us that death is not the end, that when we say goodbye, it's not final, it's merely a see you later. And we thank you for the hope most of all, through Jesus Christ, who paved the way through the cross and an empty grave. Help us to continue to live in a life that will so please you, Lord, that we will be a part of that banquet that awaits us in your home. Thank you for everything. Thank you for a life well lived. As we pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and eternal King. Amen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and to an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Would you please stand? So, having commended into the hands of God our brother departed, we now commit his body to be cremated. Ashes to ashes and dust to dust, putting our whole trust in the confidence and the mercy of our Heavenly Father, and in the victory of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who died, was buried, and rose again for us, and is alive and reigns forevermore. Amen. And so may the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each and every one of you now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
Before we go, I'd like to share a tribute that was written by my aunt Chloe, who unfortunately couldn't be here. She quotes John 17, verse 4. It says, "I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do." Mervyn, my uncle, was born into a racially diverse family, Scottish, Chinese, and African. So we grew appreciating persons for themselves and not for their color, race, or creed. His mother, my grandmother, was a fearless, no-nonsense lady with a heart of gold who loved all her offspring. Children, grandchildren, unconditionally. From her, we inherited a spirit of independence, a penchant for hard work and adventure, traits I think Mervyn displayed. Mervyn, I believe your mother, sisters, brother, and nephews were there to greet you with open arms when you took your flight to heaven. You will be greatly missed. The family regrets that because of the pandemic, those of us on this side of the Atlantic cannot be with your family at this time. Winnie and Carol, our love and prayers are with you. Over time. Thank you once again for taking the time out to share in this moment with the McNickle family. May God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you peace. And also, be safe. There's still a pandemic out there. We love each other, and we might not be able to hug each other, but the love is real. And we know, and I'm sure the family know, that we love you all dearly. God bless you all.
My way, good prayer, precious Lord, linger near. Is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, for my hand that's at all. Take my hand, precious Lord, be yours. Precious Lord, take my hand, be
Lord, lead me. Thank you. Thank you. Sam.
Sounds a bit close.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.